I will start by presenting what the world looks like from the point of view of equality of life chances. And I'm going to do it in sort of coming at it from different angles. I had wished I could have also mobilized more Finnish data, but I was unable to do so. Some of this is not my own work, and some of it is. This particular table comes from Markus Jantti's work on intergenerational income mobility. And one thing that, there are two striking features of this table that I'd like to emphasize. One is that the probability of coming from the top and remaining in the top seems to be very much in conformity with Goldthorpe's idea of the constant flux. They seem to have a steady, constant advantage, whether they are from the upper classes in Denmark or Sweden, or whether they're from the upper classes in the US. So they're overrepresented, given that this is quintiles. A neutral, fair world would have put 20% in every single of the cells. So if you have, for Denmark, for example, 36, that means there is a huge overrepresentation of children from the privileged classes that themselves end up in the privileged classes. This is quite surprising, especially when you consider that at the top, or sorry, in the bottom of the quintiles, there in some countries, here US and also UK, there is a huge reproduction of inequality compared to Denmark and Sweden, which seem to have done better. They're not down to 20%, in Denmark it's 25%, but it's getting there. So asymmetries are evident within countries, but they're also across countries. Some countries seem to have been better able to promote equality of life chances, but only from the point of view of kids coming from the bottom. So what this actually is telling us is if there is a welfare state effect here, the welfare state seems to be kind of single-mindedly, one-dimensionally, promoting life chances at the bottom, not doing much about the overprivilege at the top. Here's another way of looking at it. And this is a table, this is from my own work. And I must admit, it's a table I love, although looking at it like that, I don't think anybody can make much sense out of it. So I'm going to try to make some sense out of it. Here, I took a lot of countries. I looked at cohorts through the post-war era, beginning with a cohort, which is cohort 3, that is born somewhere around 1950, 55, in that era, the post-war baby boom cohorts, basically. Cohort 2 is born somewhere around 1960, and cohort 3 is born in the 70s. Cohort 3 is what I would call the welfare state generation. The first cohorts, at least in those countries that have what you could call a welfare state, the first cohorts that really grew up in a fully blossomed welfare state as it was there in the 70s, certainly in Scandinavia. So what I'm looking at here is what's the odds coming from a very low educated, low SES background. Essentially, what is the reference here would be a low-skilled or unskilled father, unskilled worker, essentially, a family. What is the chance, coming from that background, that you'll make it beyond upper secondary, that somehow, some kind of a tertiary education is your attainment? Now, if you start by just illustrating, looking at the US, here is a perfect situation of constant flux. The odds of making it up beyond tertiary, beyond secondary in the US is very, very low, basically 1/8, something like that. And it's the same across all three cohorts. There's been no change. Look at Denmark. I actually, as a footnote, I'm uncertain about the Norwegian data. So I ask you, please don't don't look too much at the Norwegian case. The Swedish and the Danish data are fine. Now look at Denmark, which is my home country, and back in the 1950s cohort, the Danish kids had somewhat higher chances than their equivalent American kids of making it. But look how it remains fairly the same for the 60s cohort, but then suddenly the welfare state cohort born in the 70s suddenly has doubled its chances of making it beyond upper secondary. From one cohort to the other, 10 years separating their births, more or less, suddenly they made it. Another reason I'm proud of this table is because I could control for cognitive abilities. This is the IALS data, which had included tests of cognitive abilities among all the respondents. That means I can control for talent, if you wanted, or for learning abilities, which is very important in these kind of studies, and we usually cannot. And that's why this data tells a much stronger story than we usually get. So something happened in Denmark, and you see pretty much the same story in Sweden. Suddenly, from cohort 2 to cohort 3, boom, opportunities became much, much more equalized for those who came from the very bottom of society. But that didn't happen in Germany, it didn't happen in Britain, and as I said, it didn't happen either in the US. So what is it about Scandinavia that has promoted suddenly, in a little bit, in a way, out of the blue, the doubling of the odds that you're going to make it to something bigger and better in life for those most at risk? Let me see if this one. One thing that we might think is, of course, Scandinavians, we are superior human beings, and that's the reason. That is obviously not the case. There must be something else, and it is obviously something social, something in the society. Now, here's another way of looking at the same issue. Here is basically a skill profile of what our workforce tomorrow is going to look like. Looked at it from, again, comparatively. This is looking at, in the first column, about 20, 24-year-olds, and the rest of it is PISA data, so that's 15-year-olds we're looking at. But these are PISA data from the 2000, sorry, I can't remember, 2004 or 5, 6, something like that. So these are all very much the young adults of today that are poised to enter into careers and creating our future and paying our pensions. If you look at the first column, this is the percentage of kids today that have no more than obligatory schooling. They're basically out at the age of 15. That's where it stopped. In some countries, you see a very good performance, and here Finland really is one of the world leaders. But look at US, 20% of cohorts today, kids, they end up with nothing more than obligatory schooling. They're basically unskilled. Spain is even worse, 30%. And in Spain, it's for year after year after year, 30% of kids simply drop out with nothing, no human capital in their baggage. Now, these differences clearly cannot be ascribed to genetic differences among countries. It is not that Spaniards are humanly inferior to, say, the Finns. Maybe some of you would disagree, but I don't think the Spaniards would. But look here also at the PISA data. When you get the usual PISA information, you get the mean scores, and then countries are standing there against each other and say, why are we below that other country? It's totally meaningless. The mean scores are uninteresting. What's interesting is the spread. And I took the two extremes here to illustrate. And the first one, the PISA minimum, and being below that, means essentially you're dysfunctional. Some of you probably have worked with PISA data. And one of the ways they ask and identify dysfunctionality is one of the questions, That is, you should interpret the text on the aspirin bottle. It usually says, in case of pain, no more than 2 tablets every 6 hours or something of that sort. If a 15-year-old cannot understand that message, that child will be labeled as dysfunctional, as cognitively dysfunctional. Again, we see huge differences across countries in the level of dysfunctionality among youth that are going to be paying your pensions tomorrow. In US, and Spain, almost 20% of kids are basically dysfunctional. They don't understand basic messages and can't interpret them. They clearly cannot use information in any productive way. Here, Finland and Scandinavia generally looks quite good. I am happy to say that here is, for once, a case where Denmark beats Finland in terms of educational outcomes. But then look at the elite. Those are the top 5%. Those are those that are really sort of the little Einsteins, cognitively speaking. And again, here we find these huge nation differences that cannot be ascribed to genetics. Something else must be going on among these children. And here is where Finland always scores fantastic. And here Denmark is not particularly impressive, I must say. All right. Immigrants. There are a couple of things we're beginning to see in terms of the mobility chances of immigrant kids. One of them is that immigrant boys, generally speaking, do poorly. Immigrant girls, generally speaking, do well. In some studies, in fact, immigrant girls outperform native girls in the schools. And with few exceptions, immigrant boys are just disasters, even more disastrous than native boys, who tend to also be pretty bad in school. Usually, we don't distinguish between what is a genuine immigrant effect as opposed to being what is the social composition of immigrants. Immigrants tend to be from low-educated families. They have low socioeconomic status, low income, and of course they may have language difficulties. So in the first column, I present the standard raw immigrant effect. That is, how, compared to natives, how much below the mean native score do they score on the PISA tests? And you can see in some countries, the difference is huge. Take, for example, Germany, Austria, 60 points below the mean score of native kids. But that's the raw, that is without taking account of the social composition of the immigrant population. So when you adjust it for mother's education, parental socioeconomic status, gender, and one of my favorite PISA variables, namely the amount of books you have in the home, which is a very good variable, by the way, then you get the adjusted net effect of being immigrant. And in some countries, the sign turns around. Look at, for example, the US. Now suddenly, actually, when you control for socioeconomic factors, the immigrants are actually doing better. The same is for Ireland. But in other countries, the disadvantage of immigration remains very, very strong. And if you notice, if you attach languages to these countries that are doing really badly, they're all German-speaking, essentially. There is something also there about maybe barriers, language, culture barriers in German-speaking nations that make it more difficult for immigrants. Even if you also control for origin of immigration, for example, if you were to look at Turks in a German-speaking country, Austria or Germany, they do more poorly than Turks in Scandinavia. So there may be some, the German language is very difficult for me to, I never was able to learn. All right, here we go again. Now, I'm not gonna talk about all these numbers, but there are a couple I would really like to pinpoint, and one of them I just refer to my this favorite little variable of mine about books at home, or call it cultural capital. When you study how kids perform in school in their life chances, you usually hone in always on the socioeconomic status variables, parental education, parental income, or occupational status, so forth and so on. What has been the breakthrough via PISA is that we can also measure all these much more unobservable type of characteristics in the parental home. One of them being this kind of level of cultural interaction, how bookish is the home, do they actually read books, do they even have books? So I used from the PISA data three items that I together formed into a cultural capital. One of them is high culture. How often do you go to the theater or the opera? That one actually has very little effect. The other one is how often do you sit at home, usually at the dinner table, and talk about some kind of a cultural issues, like whether it be books or art or whatever it be. It can also be culture in the very everyday sense of the word. And then the third one, the number of books on your shelves, measured in meters. I had a job when I was a student where I had to go out and take blood tests on all these boys that were in had been in military service. And so I think I visited something like 300 homes and took the blood tests. And it was just amazing to me what a large percentage of these homes, he didn't even have one book, not even one, except the telephone book. He might have had some magazines, Playboy type of magazines, but homes without even one book was just amazing to me. And then you'd get into other homes and they had 400 books or something like that. It's a very polarized world. And that is also exactly what you find when you study via the PISA data, this books in the home variable. It tends to have, and it is not correlated very strongly with parental education or parental SES. Most amazing thing. The correlation between books at home and father or mother's education is only 0.3 or 0.3 something. That is also very surprising. So the thing I would like to highlight here are two, three variables on how they influence how kids perform in the PISA test. One of them is mom's employment. Does the fact that mothers are working outside when the kids are small, does that have an adverse effect on the child's intellectual development or cognitive development? As you can see here, mother full-time has no effect that is significant. And if it does have an effect, it's actually positive. That, except for one country called Spain. And I think the reason Spain has a rather modest, but it does have a negative effect, is the working days in Spain is so long that if the parents are out working a normal day, they basically never see the kids. They come home around 7:30, 8 in the evening from their job. So they just come home to put the kids in bed and that's it. So there's not much kind of cognitive type interaction in those kind of families where also the mother works full time. And that might be the reason. Otherwise, full-time moms have no real effect of any adverse type for the kids' intellectual development. Lone mom or the lone mother effect has been played very big in the US. And US research persistently, and here Sarah McClanahan is the big name, persistently finds that lone mother families have very adverse effects, especially for the boys' life chances. And we find that here. But it's the only country in the PISA data I could find where the lone mother phenomenon has any effect whatsoever on the children. And then the cultural capital, which is the one there in bold letters. And look how big the effect is persistently across all countries. And is one of the strongest predictors of how kids do. It is perhaps the strongest. it beats the socioeconomic status variables by a big margin. And as I said, and to repeat, it is not very strongly correlated with mom's or father's education level or SES scores. It's independent of that to a large extent. Okay. Let me now move from these profiles of stratified life chances towards what happens in the family. Because clearly, if children have unequal life chances, this must be very much dictated by differentials in family life. Here is a bad kind of a bad story to tell. We are in an epoch in which there is ongoing polarization in terms of family characteristics. On many fronts, we see more and more polarization. Here is one first table that illustrates the polarizing trends. Taken from US, everything in the US is always a little bit more extreme than in European countries, but the story is the same across all advanced countries. First of all, the revolution of women's roles, the rise of female employment and lifetime dedication to employment has been prevalently at the top of the educational pyramid. And the distance or the gap between low-educated and high-educated women has risen increasingly. What that, of course, produces as a second-order effect is a rising gap in household income with two high earners at the top and one low earner in the bottom. So in terms of the income determinants of children's life chances, polarization. This is less the case in Scandinavia, maybe except Finland, where female employment is universal, at least certainly in Denmark and basically also in Sweden. But it's more and more polarizing in countries where female employment is so asymmetric, Germany being an example, and even the US, as you can see here. Another indicator of polarization is family stability. It used to be, back in the days of the early revolution, of gender revolution, that it was the high educated that were the most divorce prone. It's now reversed completely. It is now, divorce is increasingly concentrated in the bottom, and stability is rising at the top. So high educated couples are more and more stable. At the bottom, more and more unstable. Whether or not divorce or separations among the parents has a strong negative effect on children's life chances is still somewhat of a contested issue. The evidence is not really strong. It is somewhat clear that if at younger ages of the kids, the parents' divorce is much more negative than at older ages in childhood. In any case, if there are risks, and there certainly are, associated with parental divorce, we're again seeing polarization. High-educated divorce risk in the US dropped from 40% of all in any given cohort to only 18% today, whereas among the low-educated is persistently high. And then back to the American single mom phenomenon, you see again polarization. Single mom households are almost exclusively low-skilled, low-educated women. That is not just the case in the US, it's also the case in Europe. The typical single mother is more and more low-educated. And that obviously has in part to do with what I just said, namely higher educated couples and partnerships are more and more stable. Not only do we see demographic polarization that would affect potentially children's lives and their schooling chances and on into adulthood, but also on other dimensions of family life. The most visible one is parental investment and time dedication to their children. This is a tricky thing to work with because There's all kinds of time with kids. A lot of it is passive. Mom is standing there making dinner, and the kids are just kind of rolling around on the floor, and she just tells them, be quiet. That is passive kind of parenting. I have honed in here on active parenting. That is parenting where there is some kind of intellectual content, reading with the kids, playing with the kids, going for a walk with the kids, going to the zoo with the kids, so forth and so on, where there is some kind of an active parent role involved and interchange. In time use data, it's a little bit fuzzy, but I think I got it more or less here. So I look at what's the difference in active parenting time investment across the socioeconomic spectrum. And I compare high and low educated parents. And for three countries here, and basically we find the same pattern that high educated parents typically invest twice as much time in their kids as do the low educated. Or you can also say it differently. In terms of overall time dedication, the difference is not big. But low educated parents' type of parenting is much more passive childcare. Whereas the high educated is much more active interventionist investment type. There are even debates going on right now about maybe high educated parents are being sort of hyper parenting, and it's kind of gone overboard. And to some extent, I might agree with that. And the most, the most remarkable effect here comes from the rise in father involvement. That used to, if you go back to time use data in the 70s or something like that, papa was very absent from child care in the 70s. Whereas he's today very active if he's high educated. Low educated fathers have not increased their time with the kids very much, except taking them to the football game kind of activities. So given, again, the polarizing in terms of couple stability, less divorce in the top, and if the top, just like they have double incomes, also are much more likely to invest doubly in their kids, you're seeing polarization here in a very big way. It's kind of as a footnote here. What was especially interesting when I was looking at this time investment in kids, I looked at also the share of where the mother and the father jointly do the activities with the kids. And there again, the high educated do a very large share. If I remember, it was about 30% of all the time they do it together. So you can kind of picture yourselves reading for your kids there and before they go to bed, and both mama and papa are sitting there and reading together, or at least one of them reads, but they're sitting there together and doing it, rather than sort of Becker's specialization model of couple life. What the high educated are doing a lot is anti-specialization. And I think that is another indicator of a very strong sort of parental investment focus on the kids. They are really eager to sit there with the kids, maybe too much. When I studied in the university, I did a lot of courses on social stratification and inequality and poverty, that's University of Wisconsin's big focus. When we studied stratification in my days, it was all about schooling, completing university or schooling, and then your adult life. Early childhood was never mentioned in any of my courses. I don't think it was ever really put into any of those stratification models or intergenerational mobility models of the 70s and 60s. It was not there. Early childhood was viewed as that's part of the private sphere, has no role really to play in understanding intergenerational mobility. Thanks in large part to James Heckman, but more generally also to a child psychologist, developmental psychologists, when we started listening to them, which we didn't very much in sociology or economists, never listened to the psychologists, and that we were blissfully unaware of how important early childhood stimulation is in the very, very early years for later outcomes, both behavioral and cognitive. A typical cognitive development curve that a psychologist would present would look very much like this Heckman-derived learning curve. That is, it's in the first 5-6 years where it's really important. If the cognitive stimulus is insufficient in those very early years, it's very difficult, almost impossible to remedy later on. That is the lesson we learned from the developmental psychologists. James Heckman has pushed this argument maybe to the limit. And he has evaluated, re-examined, and reanalyzed all American studies that used child panel data to identify early childhood influences on later childhood and adult attainment. And on the basis of that, he's concluded exactly what I show here. That as an economist, he thinks in investment terms in terms of the rate of return to investment. And what he has estimated is a curve that is very steep in terms of, for each dollar invested in high quality child programs in the first years, you get huge returns. Some of the more recent Heckman estimates is $12 return on each dollar invested in early preschool, pre-kindergarten child programs. I don't think any stock market in the world would give you $12 to each dollar invested. That effect, though, is primarily a derivative of the fact that all the studies that Heckman has been examining are studies based on very, very vulnerable kids, very at-risk kids. So these peri-school programs, ABCDarian, and all these other American programs that are highly targeted to think of it as kind of slum ghetto kids with a lone mom who's a drug addict. That is the profile of the kind of kids that were in most of these studies that Heckman's data is based on. But generally speaking, it should be, and that is what also the social psychologists would have told us, that the more we invest in the kids' learning abilities, their behavioral characteristics very early on, the better they're going to do later in school. There is kind of a rule of thumb that children who have gone to a quality childcare institution prior to school will be 1 year ahead of those kids in grade one who were not in a quality child center before. That's a big effect. That's a very big effect. So, there are very few studies that address this issue and have tried to estimate this for Europe, looking not just at very at-risk kids, but looking at children in general. I happen to be friends with Jane Waldfogel, who is one of the American experts in this area. She has written a beautiful book, by the way, called What a Child Needs. So Jane and I got together. We happen to just be old friends. And we said, let's do a study that is not just centered on risk kids, but on all kids. And let's compare the US and Europe. And so she did the American analysis, and I did the European, and of course I took Denmark, because Denmark also has a wonderful child panel that started around 92, I think it was, and could follow up. And what we need in those data is a lot of really detailed information on their very early childhood, and we need something to measure later on, when they're already in school, their cognitive abilities or some other variables that would pick up their learning abilities. So we took these data sets that do furnish this kind of information and then ran an identical model on the two data sets as far as we could. And this is what we found. Here is the Danish data. And it's a standard OLS regression here. And we, in particular, look at the effect of having been in a high-quality daycare institution when they were small. I want to add here, and I would like to underline it, what we learned from the psychologists is that child care institutions, even if they're very good quality, in the first year of the child's life is not a very good thing. It has potentially adverse effects. But from age one onwards, it, if it's high quality, should have a positive effect. So how did I get variance on the quality of childcare? Since from age one onwards, virtually something like 90% of all Danish kids go to childcare, there's no variance in terms of those staying home with a mom. And I avoid it comparing with them because that is a very selective group. It's probably farmers to a large extent, or maybe sort of the upper class where they have four nannies and stuff. So I excluded those who didn't attend. But given that there was a shortage of the official high-quality daycare system places, they had kind of transitory compensation programs with a woman who got a month's training and would take four or five kids in her home and do daycare sort of ad hoc. So this is low quality. No pedagogical training, no pedagogical content, whereas the Danish high quality in the 90s was unbelievably high quality. It was for the 1 to 3 year olds, three, at the most, four kids per pedagogue. That is luxury. That is the Cadillac of daycare. And I don't think any country in the world has had ever mounted such a high quality system. So this is my treatment. Did they go to the high quality one? Yes or no? And you see, it has a strong positive effect. They did much better on their, this was the test of cognitive abilities when they are 11, 12 years old. So those who had gone to high quality have an effect also when they're about 11 years old that still persists. They're ahead of the rest. Controlling for parental divorce, parents' education, whether they had low birth weight, what else do I have in there? Or whether it's a boy, because the boys always do worse than the girls. All of this is controlled for. The net effect, that's very, very strong. Now, what about more at-risk kids? In Denmark, at-risk kids are not as much at risk as an at-risk kid in the United States. It's kind of a slum. Drug mom syndrome is very, very marginal in Denmark. But I took here children from families where the mother is very low educated, basically just compulsory education and hardly anything more, and where they also had relatively low income. And see, is the effect bigger? And look at it, it's much bigger. The effect for the less privileged children is much stronger than for the privileged. Or just the average kid, much stronger. So the marginal effect is exactly like my original graph there showed, much, much greater. The returns to the investment is bigger. Or you could think of it in a different way. High quality care outside the home compensates for low resources or weak resources in the home. It equalizes life chances. And here we might start getting at some potential causality. It was, to go back to the early tables I showed you, where it was Denmark, Sweden, and Norway, that had suddenly doubled the chances of the kids from the most underprivileged homes. That welfare state generation coincides with, it's the first cohort where it became the norm to go to these high quality Danish childcare centers. And I think what we're picking up here again and again and again is the equalizing effect of the Danish early childhood care system. So, if early childhood care has different effects across the social strata, then of course it's a non-linear kind of effect. And that means we shouldn't estimate with standard regression, OLS type regression. We need to catch these non-linearities to identify where precisely is the effect strong and where does it stop being strong. One way to do that is quantile regression, which I adopted here, and you're going to see it also for the US in a moment. This is Danish data, and that is across the distribution of kids in, from in terms of family background. You can see here that in the bottom quintile, that is where the effect is really strong, positive. It is somewhat strong also, but only about half or even less in the second quintile. From then on, doesn't make any effect. So somewhere around, a little below the middle of the distribution of kids, from there up, high quality care doesn't have any positive effect whatsoever. It doesn't have any negative either. It's just neutral. That all the effects are concentrated, the positive effects are concentrated in the kids in the bottom two quintiles in Denmark. Let me see if I can get this to work now. Here's the US data. And there's going to come a little surprise here. So again, we did it the same way as in Denmark. We took all kids, center care, very strong effect, poor, even stronger, poor kids at age 6. But look at age 11. Disappeared. So the effect was strong when they entered school in the US. The first school year is usually at age 6. When they entered school, they were ahead of the other ones if they had been to a high-quality center. But then it disappeared, especially for the poor. The poor kids, were the effect was undone. It wasn't undone in Denmark. It was undone in the US. And this is something that I think should be added to this kind of James Heckman kind of story that we've been getting so much. That early investment needs to be kept up year by year by year by year. Otherwise, it's going to erode. And I think the reason we had difficulty identifying it, but the data seemed to point again and again in the US case that these kids that had benefited from early quality center care, they then ended up in poor schools, the poor ones, in the local ghetto school, that where the whole effect was eroded year by year by year. And so the initial investment was, in a way, lost. And here's the equivalent American graph. It shows pretty much the same story as Denmark. That, and this is again measured at 6, because we know at by age 11 in the US, the effect was undone for the most at-risk kids. At age 6, it looks identical to the Danish. The bottom two quintiles of the kids benefit hugely, especially the really bottom is the one where the investment is fantastic. And then it becomes neutral, no effect at all for the kids from more privileged backgrounds. Now, this would suggest, thinking policy-wise, that why should we have universal child care systems? Why spend so much money on a universal child care system like Denmark does? Danish child care, which covers, as I said, just about every Danish kid from year one onwards, costs about 1.3-1.4% of GDP. It's very, very expensive. If there is only a return at the bottom, shouldn't we just have a much more targeted child care system for those in the bottom quintile, or perhaps the bottom two quintiles, and then let the rest do what they want, stay home with mom or whatever. There are two answers to this. One is the standard social policy consideration, that is, targeted programs to the poor become poor programs. And that would likely also be the case here if you had childcare only for the bottom end of society, and the middle class and upwards should take care of themselves. The financial support for the system would not be very strong, but today, if you look at these kind of opinion type data on support for the welfare state, the one program that is untouchable in Denmark in terms of public support is childcare. It's the most beloved program. Nobody across the entire spectrum of political spectrum wants any cuts in the childcare system. If it were targeted down to the bottom quintile, I think that opinion would change very, very rapidly. But there's another argument, and that is relevant for Finland, I think. Finland does exactly the opposite of what all these data tell us ought to be the case. You subsidize and give incentives for mothers to stay home and take care of their children in such a way that the incentives are marginally much stronger for low-income moms or parents than it would be for high-income career parents. So clearly you're going to have a strong selection effect, so that it is the lower educated that stay most at home with the kids, and the higher educated are the ones who are going to place their children in the daycare system. Whereas, as we just saw, it ought to be the other way around. The marginal effect for the high educated kids is zero, but the potential equalizing effect for the bottom is very, very high. Now, if that continues for a long time over cohorts and cohorts of children in Finland, I think it is possible, at least speculatively speaking, that you're going to undo those fantastic egalitarian PISA results that Finland boasts so much. And you're going to start seeing that Finland's kids tomorrow are going to be look much more like kids in Germany or kids in other countries, where there's much more of a socioeconomic gradient in how kids perform in the school system. So it all boils down to, in a sense, investment. Now, if we were to insist on a universal childcare system, even though the marginal returns for the top three quintiles is zero, is it defensible? Can we defend the investment? And there's another way you could do the accounting, and that is what I'm going to end up here with. And I found out that parallel to when I did this, Price Waterhouse did exactly the same estimation for Britain. And so they found out about my calculus, and so they contacted me from Price Waterhouse, and we actually had a meeting comparing how we had set up our estimation model, an accounting model, and it turned out by pure chance we had done it basically identically. And our results were basically identical, Denmark and Britain. So I trust this, up to a point. Now, the logic here is mama pays for herself. She pays the whole thing dynamically. Now, here is a cost calculus. We take a mom, and I took deliberately a mom who earns below mean income. She's on the lower end of the pay scale. She gets basically fully subsidized, or almost fully subsidized, for two kids, something equivalent of 2 years in the creche and 3 years in preschool institutions, subsidized by the Danish government. That means that she is able to work, and that she has her kid in a high-quality center. The gains to the mother would be, first, The cost to the government is 72,000 euro. Okay, for that mother with two kids over those years that are relevant. What does the mother gain? She gains the equivalent of about 114,000 in terms of earnings that otherwise would not have been there if she had been home with a kid. So that is, plus those of you who are familiar with Mincer models of age wage estimation know that interruptions, especially if you're on the steep side of the age wage curve, cost you a lot in the long run. The more you interrupt, the more you're going to lose ground, not just in terms of today's or tomorrow's earnings, but also in terms of future earnings. So there's a discounting factor you have to estimate here, which I estimate to be even bigger. If she interrupted those years with her two kids, she would additionally, on a lifetime basis, okay, here I calculated it up to age 50, I think, would have lost another 200,000 of equivalent euros in lost lifetime income opportunity. Altogether, by not interrupting more than the maternal leave, she has a gain of 314,000 euro, measured dynamically over many years. She pays taxes on that. And what are the gains to the exchequer? There are additional revenues from those 5 years that she works instead of stays home of 40,000 euro. And there are additional revenues coming in from the fact that on a lifetime basis, she earned more, equivalent to 70,000 euro. So the exchequer gets 110,000 krona additionally in because the mother could work rather than sit home with the kid. In other words, it has a net profit of 37,000 euro over a life course, or in a life course type of consideration or dynamic accounting. So it's a win-win. The family wins, they have two incomes. The kid is placed in a high quality daycare center. Whether or not it will benefit from it is another issue. But net of the child's benefit, the family benefits, more money. The government benefits, it has fully been paid back the initial cost of the child care center place, SIS, here we have two kids, and has actually made a little bit profit on the side. A win-win. This also tells us that in social policy terms, we should have thought about the whole issue in a very different way than we usually do. If there, additionally to that the mother can work, there are also child development gains, as we've seen there is for the bottom, there's a double investment effect here, double investment gain here. And that means if it is a true investment with returns in the long run, we should define, in terms of social policy, childcare not as a current outlay, current expenditure, but as an investment accounts. And Olli mentioned that I was sitting there with Barroso and EU and talking about social policy issues. This was a big one I advised him on. And we actually convinced the Eurocrats to start thinking about building up investment accounts for childcare in Europe, because this went along with, and that was another reason I was there, because the EU in the last years has been trying very powerfully to nurture early childcare development in its member countries. So I think the lesson here is two. One, Finland should probably turn everything upside down and think about childcare not just as a question about should mom stay home and these home subsidies, home care subsidies, but can we invest better in our kids? And where should we put our investment euros? Where should they be especially linked? And then I think the social policy community should also begin to think much more in terms of investment accounting, which makes it also much easier for government, in particular if, as right now, you have kind of a financial squeeze on the public budget. The way around it is to develop up investment accounting. That means you can borrow the money for future or future returns. And that means a current budget squeeze should have no effect and would be no argument from the politicians that would be valid. We can't afford it right now because we're in a crisis. Not a valid argument if you can argue this is an investment objective, not a current consumption issue. And so that's where I will stop. I hope I wasn't too boring. Thank you.